Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for joining me today for this special art lesson about Suzanne Valadon. Before I continue, I just want to suggest that you pause the video, go down to the video description right now, and click on the link that will take you to a blog post that I made with supplemental photographs, images, links, and such. That's going to give you a better art lesson experience today because you'll be able to check out some images and things that I talk about. You might pause the video, open a new window, and just click on that. And also, I want to say if you like this video, go ahead, show your support by giving a thumbs up, subscribing to my channel, sharing this video with a friend, and maybe leaving a comment. Tell me what you like. Tell me what you want to see more of. I'd love to hear back from you. Also, if you want to show financial support, I have a PayPal and a Venmo account with links below. So, Suzanne Valadon. I learned about Suzanne Valadon only recently. Shout out to Professor Michael Fowler for his awesome Women in Art History class that I took last semester. This is the painting. It's called The Blue Room. It was made in 1923. This is the painting that made me go, whoa, it blew my mind. Because this looks like someone I know. I mean, honestly, this painting looks like something that would have been made 2 years ago or, you know, 2 days ago. It looks so contemporary. It has such a timeless quality to it. The thing I love about this painting so much is that the model, Suzanne Valadon, she is just living her life in her comfy PJs, smoking her cigarette, reading her books, and just letting it out and not caring out what the viewer thinks. There is millions of examples of nude figurative paintings of women painted by men, you know, just, yeah, lying back passively, just looking like decoration. You know, women weren't even allowed to paint naked people for a very long time. Attitudes shifted. In the late 1800s, we begin to see women painting nudes more frequently. And the first nude self-portrait was made in 1906, I believe, by an artist named Paula Moderson Becker. Another thing about Suzanne Valadon that's really important is that she was a model. She was born in 1865, I believe, in France. She was born into poverty. She didn't attend school. There's a story that she joined the circus for a short time, but she began to model for other artists when she was 15. And you have probably seen paintings made with her as the model. Renoir used her as a model, and a host of other artists. There's many examples given in this book. Apparently, she was sought after because of her striking looks, but also because she could hold a pose really well. Another thing that's so fascinating to me is that she would watch the artists who were painting her and she would ask them questions, and that's how she received her art education. So she didn't attend a formal institution to learn how to paint. She picked up pointers on how to paint from the guys that painted her. She became known for these dark lines that she painted around her people. And another thing that I really love is the way her brush strokes, these small brush strokes that go around the form of the painting, of the arm or whatever. I love that. And that's what we're going to try to do today when we're making our own figurative paintings. Suzanne Valadon lived in Paris. That's where her studio was. She has a very interesting life story. She modeled when she was 15 to about 18 or so, and later on as well. But that's when she met Renoir and apparently had an affair with him when she was around 18. He was in his 40s. She became pregnant and he never claimed her child. And I don't think she ever really overtly said he was the father, but she did have a son. Maurice Uccello is the name of her son, and he became a painter as well. The other very interesting aspect about Suzanne Valadon is she eventually fell in love with a young man who was friends with her son. He was 20 years younger than she was. And she actually made a painting called Adam and Eve of the two of them. And this was the first time a woman made a nude painting of a man and a woman. So that painting was very significant. And before she was allowed to show it publicly, she was asked to paint the ivy over his groin. And she did not want to do that. She hesitated and eventually just gave in and did it because she wanted to show the painting publicly. So there's a lot of fun and interesting stories about Suzanne Valadon that I'm encountering as I learn more about her. I wanted to say this book has been really beautiful to look at. There was recently an exhibition of Suzanne Valadon's work at the Barnes Foundation in Philadelphia, and I was really hoping to get to it. I wasn't able to get there, so I ordered the book instead, and it's filled with tons of beautiful paintings by her and essays about her. So Suzanne Valadon was also well known for her figurative paintings of women and the way she painted women. And people often think, it's often assumed that she had an inclination towards painting the humanity and the personality of the women, her subjects, because she knew what it was like to be a model, because she had that experience. So there's more fun info about Suzanne Valadon. But we are going to go ahead and we're going to try to make a painting based on her work and her approach. So one thing I would encourage, if just to be very, very basic, if figurative painting is new to you, I want to encourage you to just make a reproduction of this painting of the Blue Room, because there's so much interesting stuff here. And you will learn so much just by reproducing this painting. Another thing you might try doing is make a reproduction of this painting, but put your face on it, or even your body. Try to emulate aspects of your body into this. But the third thing you might try doing is a whole new painting, using elements from this and being inspired by this, but launching off into something new. So that's what I'm going to do, and maybe you will join me now. So for this assignment, you'll want a canvas of some sort. You could also work on paper. I am going to work on canvas, and I'm going to work with oil paints because that's what Suzanne Valadon worked with. If you do not want to do that, if you would rather work with acrylics, of course, that is great. You might try using Golden's Open brand acrylics because they stay wet longer, so they work a little bit more like oil paints. This brand, Open. You can also get a medium, a clear medium that's just called Golden Open Medium, and you can mix it with your regular acrylic paints and it will make them dry a lot slower. So they work a little bit more like oil paints that way. But I am going to work with oils today. And in order to do that, I'm going to use some gloves. You want to have windows open. You want to have ventilation going when you're working with oils. So in order to do the project I have in mind, you will need a photograph of yourself reclined in any gosh darn way you want to be. This is about capturing the essence of the Blue Room. You know, we're not trying to look pretty. We're not trying to look cool, like, you know, we are just being ourselves, living our life, being as comfortable as we need to be. So I will quickly show this picture of me with my cat. Okay, and that's what I'm going to be referring from today. I'm going to work with this pose here, but I'm going to use the pants, the striped pants, and put that in here. Use some of these patterns and put it in here. I haven't smoked for a long time, but maybe I'll throw a cigarette in there, some books, things that I like. I'm going to contemporize this painting a little bit more, even though, like I said, I think it's timeless and awesome as it is. But I'm going to make this my own using that for my inspiration. So to start, I'm going to work with burnt sienna to start with. But it's up to you how you want to do this. If you haven't made a figurative painting in a long time, you have all these really great references by Suzanne Valadon. You have all these great paintings that you can work from. Look at the way she paints around the arms and the body and the color she uses for the flesh in her paintings are just so interesting to me. So if you just take that from the painting and try working with those things, don't try to make these like beautiful classical realist paintings. This is a fun painting of yourself, perhaps, or a friend if you wish. It doesn't have to be yourself. And we're just going to enjoy the process. So I have some this is actually odorless solvent. I'm going to start with, I have a variety of brushes here, different shapes and sizes. The smallest is this, number 2, bright. I've got a couple of rounds here to work with. And I'm going to start with my burnt sienna and just lay out the composition. Sometimes I like to mix a little dark blue into my burnt sienna also. I'm going to do that. I'm mixing those two together. So when you work on a figure, just loosely try to get the main form. We're not going for total perfection right now. We're just trying to place it. One of the things about my photograph that I did intentionally is there isn't an awkwardness to the pose. And I did that because Suzanne Valadon often, you know, when she first was drawing, she made a lot of drawings of girls and their mothers bathing. And the poses were really awkward. And the girls were not looking at the viewer. They were just doing their own thing, not aware of the artist, the painter. And some of the poses are very awkward, of them getting into the tub. Some of them are holding mirrors up to their bodies, looking at their bodies. And so I decided I would do a similar thing with my pose. But trust me, this pose that I'm working from was done very spontaneously. And one of the things I'm not liking is the way it is floating on the canvas. So you can, this is what's fun about oils. You can wipe it out and you can start again. I'm always amazed with painting how you can do all this work to get all these details and all these like interesting things, and you have this amazing like image, and it can be wiped away so easily. Okay, I'm going to tilt this so it's more like that. So. And the other thing that's nice about oils is you can just wipe them away like this, and you could do just a series of gestural paintings to begin with before you actually commit to anything. And that's kind of nice too. Love looking at the way Suzanne Valadon painted hands. She really delineates each finger, and there's a real nice strength to her hands. She's not like shying away from making hands. And some of the hands she makes look really awkward and really like not anatomically correct. But I like that she just did it. She just went for it and did those hands and feet. And she wasn't hiding them or, you know, trying to cover them up. I do want to suggest, you know, the scale I have this at is quite small, and I think painting big is really fun. I really enjoy it. So if you have a big canvas and you want to take that leap and you want to try to make a big painting, I encourage you to do that. So I've painted this interior, and I am going to do something here on the wall. For now, I'm just going to paint in this room, this space here. There's a lot of space here in the foreground for me to really, you know, maybe play with the pattern of the bed sheet or you know, have some magazines, have some books sprawled around. Maybe the stripes, we have to incorporate these stripes. We have to incorporate these awesome green and white stripes somewhere in the painting, whether it's on the clothes you're wearing, the pattern of the sheets. There's this beautiful blue flowers here. This background is so interesting. Also, we have books. Look at those cute little feet. Like when you really are, you know, if you can print out the image and really study it and really, you know, examine the qualities of it that make it so great. So I will say one thing, I've never seen from Suzanne Valadon's paintings, I have never seen her paint a cat. So I get to do my own interpretation. of a cat here. So something else you can do with oils that's really fun, or with the open acrylics, if you have them, is you can just put down some dark, you know, like a very thin, you know, use your solvent, thin out your paint. And then you can actually take your rag and start, you know, do like a backwards type of a thing and wipe away places where the highlights will go. So you might let this painting just evolve as you go, or you might have it all planned out. You might have all of the details, all of the objects planned out ahead of time. I tend to like to let paintings just sort of evolve, but I have noticed if I have more of a plan going into it, it does make things a lot easier for me, but sometimes you lose that spontaneity with your painting. You know, I think it's great to try both approaches. It's funny that I'd rather you see the painted version of myself than the photograph. We can analyze that for days if we want to. So another artist I mentioned earlier named Paula Moderson Becker, she painted what's considered perhaps the first nude self-portrait. And she made it in 1906, and she didn't show it to anyone, which I find really interesting. It was never shown publicly. So it's interesting to me that, you know, for whatever reason, she just said she wanted to paint herself naked. Now, she made a painting of herself, where she looked pregnant. She appears pregnant in the painting, but she was not pregnant at the time. She was actually leaving her husband. And yeah, she just made this painting like maybe as a personal affirmation, like just for herself and no one else to see. I'm gonna start layering some color. I know you can't, there's nothing much here to see. I'm going to take a flat brush here, and I'm going to start mixing some kind of a skin tone for myself. You might try, you know, mixing yellow and red with some white, and perhaps a little bit of blue, which is going to neutralize it. That can be a good start, depending on what your skin tone is. Burnt sienna is a good place to start also. And either add yellow and white to it, or red, white, and yellow, and just see what happens. And I'm just mixing a little bit of solvent into my paint now. You can exaggerate, elongate, do all kinds of interesting things with your form. It doesn't have to be anatomically like correct. I like to build the painting up in layers, working loosely and then going in for a little more detail. So you might have a favorite shirt or something like that that you want to include in your painting. Or, you know, take the clothing from the blue room, take her clothing and use that. So yeah, I'm just loosely putting all this in. Okay. Another artist that painted herself nude was a woman named Florine Stettheimer, who she's another one I just recently found out about. Really fascinating. I think Andy Warhol said she was his favorite artist. She was a socialite in New York, had a lot of money, and she made a large nude painting of herself based on the painting by Manet called Olympia. And she did show it publicly. There's actually a painting, another painting she made of, I think it's called Soiree, and it's of one of her salons. She would have these salons at her house where she would show art, invite people and talk about art. And in this painting that she made, she has her work of art in it. So she's referring to her painting inside of the painting. And this is something I am really fascinated by, when artists refer to their own painting in a painting. So with that said, I encourage you, do you have a painting you made that you can hang, you can put on the walls of your of this painting? I know Suzanne Valadon did not necessarily do that, but I think it's a really fun and interesting way to refer to yourself, to be self-referential. A lot of artists will do that. A lot of musicians, singers will refer to lyrics from old songs. Kind of like a little surprise, or what's called an Easter egg, for people who are in the know. They will catch on to it. So I'm going to do that with this painting. I am going to put some kind of painting on the wall, something I've made. I don't know what yet. So I'm just using this time right now to block in the composition. There's a lot of blue in, you know, it's called the blue room. And you may really explore blue in this painting. Now I know a lot of people like to use phthalo blue. Phthalo blue was not a pigment at the time when Suzanne Valadon was painting. She probably used ultramarine, Prussian blue, maybe cerulean. You know, I am really interested in pigments and the history of pigments. So I might research that a little better, like what kind of blues were used during her time. I think I would consider her a post-impressionist, not so much, you know, while she was definitely influenced by the Impressionists, her work came a little bit later and isn't quite as interested in capturing light the way the Impressionists were. There are some landscapes that she did that are really gorgeous and still lifes. I have to admit, I'm mainly compelled by her figurative paintings, especially her nudes. I love the way she paints the body. Okay. She uses pattern a lot in her paintings. She uses different patterns. And really like gets into it, like the tapestries and such. This might be where I put the greed lines, by the way. So are there any fun objects, any other things that you can incorporate into your painting, things that are personal to you? I have this little dresser here that has a hot water bottle on it. Or you might put a vase of flowers or a sculpture you made back there, or a sculpture a friend gave you. Maybe throw some books. I've got an iPad here. I could put that here. Maybe like a shirt or something in the foreground. So, like I said before, Suzanne Valadon, a very defining characteristic of her paintings are those beautiful dark lines that define the edges of her forms. So I am going to use some of those right now and try to get a little more, show a little more detail here. I discovered this color, Corbe Green by Williamsburg Paints. I love it. It's a dark green. It's an amazing dark green. Williamsburg is made by Golden Paints. Really awesome quality. Not inexpensive paints to work from. So I like to give myself a lot of dark colors that I can warm up or lighten up with opaque colors. So I start with dark. I'm going to start with the Corbe Green, this primary cyan. I really like this. Alizarin Crimson is a favorite of mine. Burnt Umber is a good one to work from. I'm going to use those for the dark parts of my painting. And then I like to use more opaque colors like yellow ochre, cadmium yellow, medium, cadmium red, white, to lighten up the colors. Thank you. So yeah, the thing with oils is they stay wet much longer. So if you have, you're trying to paint over something that's wet, just do yourself a favor and wipe it out. If it's still wet, just wipe it away because it's going to be a lot easier. Now with acrylics, that's not necessarily the case. Acrylics, your thing may have already dried and it would be easy to paint over. I'm going to make the pants red. I'm just going to change it up here. I love how Suzanne Valadon paints feet and just how substantial the feet are that she makes. So I'm going to try to do that with my painting also. Now, I want to keep the pattern of one blanket and maybe make the other the stripes from her pants. And then there's those beautiful flowers on her bed sheet also, which maybe I'll put on the pillow here. Make a couple pillows with that blue floral. If you have a big section to fill, use a bigger brush. Try using a bigger brush. So for now, I'm just blocking in the primary shapes. And this is where, in my head, I am working out the composition a little bit more. But, you know, maybe you've already got everything figured out. Maybe you made a preliminary sketch and you're just putting it together. But this is the, this is the part of the painting where I just kind of block things out. So, I think I'll do all this with the original bed sheet print of mine, and then I'll make the striped sheet over here. Sometimes when I'm still trying to figure this part out, I'll just take a rag, some paint, and then just wipe it on. There is no particular reason why I used pink as the base color for this painting. It's just something I paint. I had another painting on this canvas, and I happen to paint over it with this kind of pink magenta color. So I like when that shows through sometimes, but it was something I did a while back. I wasn't doing it purposefully for this video. So it's probably going to take me a few sittings with this painting to really finish it. But the thing I want you to try to push in your painting, if you look at Suzanne Valadon's brush work, when you're making, you know, when you're painting, let's say the limbs of your piece, maybe switch to a smaller brush and try to take on her small brush strokes that she does with the limbs and even some of the colors that she uses. You don't have to be so literal with the colors. And this is why it's nice if you could, paint a little bit bigger, because I think you'll enjoy this part of the process a lot more. Mixing a little bit of yellow ochre into my piece. And I'm also looking at my picture, but I'm also looking at her painting to inspire me as I go. If your colors are getting muddy, which is a very common occurrence with oils, just slow down, clean off your brush, pick a new brush. Wait a minute, go to a different section of the painting. There's all different things you can do. You don't have to struggle. I always have a rag handy to wipe off my brush as I'm working. Try to keep your brush strokes, just for the sake of this painting, try to keep your brush strokes light. It's almost like you're laying the paint on top of the painting as opposed to blending it so much. Just lay it on top. And don't make it perfect and finished. Move into a different part of the painting, then come back to that. There's a really nice aspect to a painting when, you know, not everything necessarily has to be resolved. So don't worry about making, you know, one thing totally perfect before moving into the next. You know, you're building up the painting as an entire entity. So you can come back to these things that you're painting. And I know this arm is much bigger than it should be in real life, but I am going to just embrace that and enjoy that distortion a little bit. Come in and do some detail here in the face a little bit later. Mix a yellow, light pale, kind of yellow green, and this will be, you know, maybe where I do some of these vines that are on the bed sheet here. Some of this stuff. And again, I'm just trying to capture the essence of it. I'm not super invested in doing everything, you know, with all the perfect details. But it, like when I'm painting and I'm just studying how she did all of that awesome stuff, it's just so incredible to look at. And then maybe I'll map in where some of these green and white lines will go. I'll put some of it under here. I'm going to take a little break with this. I will post the results on the link that you all hopefully are looking at. So you maybe already have seen the results. And I would love to see what you come up with. So please send me your images if you worked on any and your thoughts, leave a comment, subscribe. Do you know something cool about Suzanne Valadon that I don't know? Please share it with me. I hope you learned something about Suzanne Valadon today. I hope I was able to make you love her the way I love her. So Until next time, thank you so much for joining me and have fun painting. Bye.